Let's all stand.
Bye.
died upon the cross for my sins. I love you.
God is still good.
I'm glad I know him.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, I'm good. You know what? We wouldn't do without
him. As I look back on all of my days, so many times in so many
worthy of
I've missed June's.
Yes, I know a bubble, tell me so.
Little
one,
tell me
so. They are weak and mighty strong.
Yes,
Jesus will be. Yes, Jesus will me. Yes, Jesus
will me.
A bubble tells me so.
Make a world and hold it in my hands. I cannot make the lightning flash across the land. I cannot take a piece of clay and mold it into man. But I have a Father. I have a Father.
Amen.
Who can.
Amen.
Now he sets high,
high,
and he looks low,
and he guides my feet wherever I go.
When I don't understand,
I
have a Father. A cloud and ascend it in the sky. I cannot love humanity so much that I would die. I cannot even name the stars or count the grains of sand. But I have a Father, a heavenly Father. Who can. Now he sits
high,
and he looks low,
and he guides my feet wherever I go.
When I don't understand,
I
have a Father.
I have a Father.
God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
us sing.
He's coming soon. He's coming soon. He's coming soon. He's so good to me.
Marlon, you sure? You and Julie ain't got nothing. Okay. Maybe another time, then. Maybe next time. How much that? Anybody else got a... Been a good day, ain't it? Been a good day in the Lord. Man, It's so good. I can't say enough how good it is just to assemble back together. It does my heart good to seeing people. I walked back through there a minute ago and saw people raising their hands and praising the Lord. And I said it to myself, I've missed this. And I know you have too. I was thinking there, I noticed we get to talking about how good God is and the songs that we sing. God is still good. And I thought about, you know, how when we brag on the Lord, business picks up. You notice that? Yeah. Way the Spirit of God you can't manufacture that. But you get to bragging on the Lord and get to singing about the blood. And if that don't get you excited, I don't know what will. Amen. Get to bragging on how good God is. No matter what's going on in your life, all of us can say God is still good. Amen. God is still good when the waves roll high. God is still good all through the night when I've done all I can and I don't understand. God's still good. Amen. The Primitives sang a song years ago. He's good when I'm happy. He's good when I'm sad. And he's good when I'm somewhere in between. Now, there's a lot of days I'm somewhere in between. But God is still good, ain't he? Amen. Good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. All right, turn with us in the book of John, chapter number 15. And we'll read a verse of scripture there. And then I'm going to go over to Matthew 18. John 15, and I'm going to start verse number 1. John 15, verse number 1. If you're able, stand with us tonight. Honoring God's word. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye
abide in me. I am the vine, you're the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. All right, Matthew chapter number 18, in verse number 7, verse 7. Woe unto the world because of offensive. I'll give you just a minute to find that. Matthew 18, verse number 7. Woe unto the world. I hear papers still rattling. I'll give you a minute. All right. Woe unto the world because of offenses, for it must needs be that offenses come. But woe unto that man whom by the offense cometh. Wherefore, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt and or maim, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out, cast it from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones, for I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reading of your word tonight and pray, God, that you just get us out of the way. Lord, you'd use us for your glory and your honor. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the blessed hope that we have, Lord, as Christians tonight. And thank you, God, for your word, God, that puts things in perspective of where we are and where we need to be. And we love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right, you may be seated. Now in John 15, very familiar scripture about Jesus said, I am the vine, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. He said, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, begin to think about pruning things, and it's time, this time of the year, before the sap comes up and into the trees, and it's starting to already come up in the trees, and before they start budding, is a good time to prune. Fruit trees and your grapevines and all that stuff, rose bushes but especially your fruit trees. And I was thinking of this scripture yesterday, and the Lord really dealt with my heart about it. I was trimming a apple tree yesterday, and the way you trim something. Now I was thinking of John 15:2. It says, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, in pruning, first thing we think of, we find the dead limbs, right? Any kind of dead limbs would hinder the growth. And the friend that I was trimming this tree, they told me, they said, well, I've got fruit on my tree, but they ain't very big. It's an apple tree, but my apples ain't very big. And when I went out there behind the house, I could see that there was a lot of growth that was hindering. There's a lot of clutter, if you will, that was hindering from that apple tree bearing the fruit that it needed to bear. Now, when I walked up there, I noticed there was a lot of undergrowth. Things down here, and there was a lot of what you'd say saplings or suckers that would grow up, and all these hinder the growth and the potential of this apple tree bearing the fruit that it needs to bear. It's a stamen wine sap, and a stamen wine sap apple is good apple butter making apple, right? In its potential, it'll grow apples like that, if it's fertilized and if it's pruned right. Pruning is very important, but pruning takes some work, don't it? All right, so not only do you look and you find the dead limbs, but you look for the branches that is crossing each other. Now, it don't make sense, really. You don't really think about it when there's no leaves on the tree, but the branches that are crossing one another, they're smothering one another out when the sunlight hits. A lot of those leaves and limbs underneath, they're not getting the potential sunlight, what they need to grow and to bear fruit. So clutter can hinder the growth of an apple tree. So that's the first thing you look for. Besides the dead limbs, you get the deadness out, because dead limbs will hinder the potential growth of a tree as well. But also, the limbs that are crossing one another, you get the clutter out. And what happens is you're opening it up, and that happens a lot in the middle of the apple tree. And so when you open that up, it lets the sun, let the sun shine in. And the more sunlight and the more airflow that goes through that apple tree, the more it helps the fruit and the fruit bearing. And so I was thinking about our Christian life, and boy, I was whittling away yesterday on this thing. It'd been a while, if it had ever been pruned, been a while since this thing been pruned. I don't think it had, because I didn't see any places where any cuts had been made, because they was limbs growing out under down here close, and close to the ground, not far from the ground. So I started whittling away, and I stopped, and I thought, man, it feels like I'm killing this thing. And so I stood back and got a better look at it. And while I was able to stand back, I was able to see that wasn't killing it. I was helping it. And the tree or the limbs in the middle, there was a lot of clutter in the middle, so you have to open that up. And I've done a little research and just before I started to make sure that I was doing it the right way, and there's always a standard, like we talked about this morning. You can always go back to a reference, and I'm thankful that in God's Word we can go to a reference and find what's cluttered up in our life. Clutter in your life can hinder your growth as a Christian. And I was thinking of all the things that's hindering our fruit bearing. And God, Jesus said, it is His will that we bear much fruit. Amen. We should be fruitful in the Lord, fruitful in the Spirit of God, in the fruits of the Spirit. Amen. But there's things that can hinder your fruit. And I believe a lot of things in our life that don't need to be there. And now you think about it, these limbs were bearing fruit. They still was. They bud out and they'll bear an apple on them. But the thing of it is, all them little saplings and them little branches there, they were hindering the main growth. And what you try to think of when you trim a tree, you think about you have at least three main branches coming up from the trunk. And you go off of them three main branches is what you want to focus on. Anything that's in the middle, you want to take it out. Because I know you think, man, that looks awful good. And that looks awful good there, but it's hindering the growth. Now, there's things in our life, and it might seem good, and it might keep you in the comfort zone, and it might be pleasing to the flesh, but if it's hindering the growth in your life and your spiritual growth in the Lord, it ain't worth it. Now, I was thinking, before I trimmed it, I asked the lady, I said, now, what's your plan? She said, well, the apples are small. I want the apples to be bigger. That's the whole purpose of this pruning. Now, I want to think about this. It's hard for a lot of people to be reproved and to be rebuked. But the Word of God, amen? I think about what Paul told Timothy. He said, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Now here's the thing. It's hard. It's hard to be pruned. But God's Word will take the dead limbs out of your life. But God's word not only will take the dead limbs out of your life, but God's word will prune you up with clutter in your life. Let me say this. I believe with all good intentions, just like them other little branches that's bearing fruit, but it's hindering the growth. I believe a lot of bad habits that we obtained in our Christian life that hinders our growth. Jesus said not to pray with vain reputations. Vain repetitions. I believe in our prayer life, we can have a lot of clutter. Amen. We could just be going through a list and really not praying fervently. Amen. But I believe when we get down to business with God, amen, not going through a list, not going to a repetition prayer, but ringing the prayer bells of heaven, I believe our prayers will be more effectual and fervent. Amen. Fervent means hot. Amen. I don't believe that if we just nonchalantly pray, I believe, and with our minds focused upon what we're saying, I believe we get distracted. There's distractions in our life that will distract our prayer life. We'll distract. We was talking about this the other day up the mill. Have you ever noticed when you go to read the Bible, everything in the world comes to your mind? Now, you might not have this problem, but I do. Have you ever noticed when you go to pray, everything in the world goes to your mind? Things that you normally wouldn't think of, but you start thinking about it. There's clothes in the washer that needs to be dried. Now, I wouldn't normally think about stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? All these distractions, clutter things in our mind. But I'm thankful that God knows how to clean that up, don't he? Amen. Amen? I was thinking about Matthew 18. If thy hand offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life a halter maim rather than have two hands or two feet to be cast in everlasting fire. And if thy hand offend thee, or thy eye, excuse me, if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. It is better for thee enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. These are stumbling blocks. These are things that are causing us to stumble. There's things in our life, and I believe Jesus used these illustrations. I don't believe literally that he meant for you to pluck your eye out or take your hand off. But there's things that we feel like in our life that we have to have that we really don't need. That is an hindrance. I believe that gadgets and a lot of things that the internet and our cell phones taking away time that God wants to spend with us. Amen. I don't expect to get a whole lot of amens here. But listen, I'm not here for entertainment. I believe that a lot of things that we are wrapped up in that are hindering our spiritual growth with God. This might offend you. And I realize tonight I'm on Facebook Live, but I believe if we get off of Facebook and get back in God's book, I believe that our lives would have more power with God. I believe our churches would have more power with God. Amen. Amen. Clutter. Things that we don't consider as wrong. Things that are not as bad as other things, but still things that are causing, just like them little saplings. Oh, they look pretty. They look good. They look like they could really help the tree out. But what they're doing, they're smothering the tree. They're hindering their growth. They're hindering the fruit. Amen. There's things in our life, and let the Holy Spirit of God speak to your heart tonight of whatever it is. There's things in our life that are hindering our fruit. But we think, well, we'll just leave it there. It ain't hurting nothing. But come fruit-bearing time, it tells on us. Come fruit-bearing time, I already got rid of that limb. Fruit-bearing time is when we see God blessing good time is in church. In church. We serve the Lord out there. We worship Him in here. Amen? Fruit-bearing time. And when the Spirit of God, if the Spirit, you know, I believe a lot of times we can quench the Spirit of God. We can quench the Spirit of God in our daily lives and hinder, amen, our fruit in the Lord. Amen. And I think about it in our daily devoted life. If we are not reading God's Word and studying God's Word and talking to God and having fellowship with God, it will hinder your growth in the Lord of things you understand, the way you behave, the way you handle situations. Amen. I believe a lot of times the reason why we're at our wits' end is, but it's a result of our growth in the Lord, or lack of growth in the Lord. I believe the reason why a lot of times we act the way we do, and the reason why that we get so fretful, and the reason why we get so fearful, is because of a lack of a knowledge in God's Word a lot of times. Amen. I believe that I was talking to a lady, and it blessed me the other day. She was talking. She said, I know I'm saved. And she said, this is how I know I'm saved. She said, because I noticed before I was saved, it didn't bother me when I did wrong. But it does now. I said, boy, that's a good sign right there. Yeah, she said, it didn't bother me to laugh at them ugly jokes that was being said in the office, or it didn't bother me when I said bad words and when I said bad things, but it does now. And I said, that's the Holy Spirit of God living in you, letting you know when you've done right or wrong. She said, and preacher, she said, I've also noticed that the Word of God has more meaning than it ever has. She said, I've noticed, and she said, I'm ashamed. I'm getting older in life, I'm ashamed that I have not read God's Word like I should have. But she said, I am thankful that God has brought me to have the appetite for His Word. And she said, when I read God's Word, the Word of God just opens up and I understand it. And she said, where I couldn't before, but God has given me the understanding. And she said, it has been a great, great difference in my life. She said, it has changed my life. God's Word will change your life. God's Word will change your fruit. God's Word will change your behavior. God's Word will change your language. Amen. When a man seems to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, this man's religion's in vain. Amen. From out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. People say, oh, I can't help it. You can. Amen. You can. Man, when you have the Lord, you got a heart problem. Whatever. From out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So if what's coming out of the mouth is bad, is something bad in your heart. Amen. Need to get that taken care of. But I'm thankful that when we, and here's the thing. It takes swallowing pride to be pruned. To be pruned and allow God to prune us. It takes being honest to be pruned. Being honest with yourself. See, that's the thing. Being honest with yourself. A lot of times we try to deceive ourselves. Well, that's all right. Well, that ain't wrong. Let me say this. If the Holy Spirit of God's already said it's wrong, no matter what kind of excuse you try to bring up, it's wrong. Now, here's the thing. They might be, and I believe everybody ought to work out their own salvation with fear and trembling. That's what the Bible tells us. And what that means is whatever is that convicts you, I believe we ought to live by our convictions. If it convicts you, don't do it. If your right hand offends you, cut it off. That's what that means. If whatever, and I know that there's different things that might bother some, that it might not bother others. Right? It might be going to a ball game. It might not bother some people. You might say, well, what's wrong with that? Maybe nothing. But if it's wrong to somebody, if they feel bad of going to somewhere like that, don't condemn them. Amen? That's between them and the Lord. And vice versa. If it bothers you and doesn't bother somebody, don't condemn them either. Now, here's the thing. There's only one that we're going to give account to, and that's God. Amen? But I begin to think about the Hebrews 12. The Bible says, wherefore, seeing we're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doeth so easy beset us. That's your weakness. Everybody's got a weakness. I don't care how long you've been a Christian. Don't know. Does it matter of your knowledge in the Bible? Does it matter how much power you have with God? You still have a weakness. Everybody's got a weakness. And that's the sin that doeth so easily beset you. That's the sin that you're easy to give into the most. Everybody's got one. We all might, some of us might have more than one. Amen? But here's the thing. That sin that doeth so easily beset you will hurt your growth. And hurt your fruit in the Lord. You might say, well, preacher, what I do is not hurting nobody but me. Wrong. Somebody might come around and want to eat off your tree one day. Somebody might come along and say, sir, could you tell me how to be saved? Could you? Could you lead somebody to the Lord through the Word of God? Not just giving them your opinion, but take them biblically through the Word of God and teach and tell them about the Lord and lead them to Christ. If you can't, then there's a fruit problem. There's something that's hindering your growth in the Lord. It's very important. You don't have to be a preacher to lead somebody to the Lord. If you're saved by the grace of God, you need to be fruitful in the Lord to lead somebody to Christ. Amen. That's the Great Commission, ain't it? Amen. So, And not only that, but I believe that we need to have fruit with the Lord that somebody not only might come by and want to eat off our tree for salvation, but somebody might just need some godly advice. Thank God for people that's been faithful to God, that has had salt about them. The Bible says salt is good. Have salt in yourselves, amen. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be seasoned? It is fit for nothing but to be trodden under the foot of men. Amen? And so, here's the thing. When somebody has salt in the Lord and has the power of God on them and has the knowledge of the Lord and wisdom, and I'm thankful to the people that's been in my life that I could go to and talk to them spiritually. And talk to them for guidance and for some spiritual direction. And I'm the Lord wants us to come and talk to Him most of all. Amen. But ain't it good to have some good godly people you can depend on? Amen. That you know that they're seasoned in the Lord. And that they just ain't going to talk about just anything. And they ain't going to tell you their opinion. They're going to give you some good godly wisdom. That's somebody that's bearing good fruit. Amen? And wisdom from the Lord, there's nothing carnal about godly wisdom. There's nothing worldly about godly wisdom. Amen? That spiritual wisdom that's from above is the growth in the Lord. And that knowledge and wisdom that God has given them. Amen? It ought to challenge every one of us because, listen, there's been a lot of good people in this church that's been good fruit bearers. But they're gone to be with the Lord. Now, who's bearing that good fruit that others may come? It's our job. You know, we've looked, well, it's so-and-so and so-and-so. They're good. They're good people. They're people we can depend on. How about you? Can't people depend on you? Can't I depend on you? How about my youngins? Can my youngins depend on you? I need you. My youngins need you. Others' youngins, they need you. They need for you to be bearing fruit in the Lord. Amen? Not to be like the fig tree that had leaves but no fruit on it. But God, and we need one another. And that's why it's important. Amen. You've heard me say, when we come to church, we need to be led by the Spirit of God. And if God don't give you nothing to say, you need to keep your mouth shut, because you could hinder the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is easily offended. Amen. We need to be led by the Spirit of God. We need not to quench the Spirit of God. But when we are led by the Lord, and when the Lord gives us something to say, and we say it, we will edify, we will lift up, we will help the church. Amen. And lift him up. Amen. That's what it's all about. I remember them telling about Motel Hensley. She was pretty well sick and homebound when I got here, when I got to meet her. But boy, she had the Lord on her even at home. And I remember you guys telling me she would stand up, and she wouldn't stand up very often. But, buddy, when she stood up, she had something to say. And she said, "I've got just a word." And that word, buddy, it was the key to the service. People begin to praise the Lord. People begin to come to the altar getting help. And that's just by obeying the Lord. Amen. That's a fruit, having fruit and bearing good fruit in the Lord. I was thinking about this. There's apples. They'll get that blossom rot. Tomatoes are notorious for it. The blossom end rot. It'll look pretty. You flip it over and it's got a black spot on it. It's rotten. And I believe there's a lot of times in our life that we might be bearing fruit, but it ain't the best fruit we could bear. There is a way to keep that blossom end rot from happening. There's a spray for it. You spray them blooms before it even makes a tomato. Same way with the apples. There's other spray for apple trees that keeps from that rotting happening as well. But especially tomatoes, you spray that bloom, and you spray apple trees and peach trees as well for this. But what happens is, before anything begins to even start, you spray it and you take care of it. And then when the fruit comes, you don't have to worry about it. Amen. In our life, if we take care of it before it even starts, sin will grow, and sin is like a canker, the Bible says, like cancer, isn't it? And it'll just eat and eat, and it will affect your fruit in the Lord. And not only will it affect you, but it'll affect others around you. You've heard me say, what I do is not hurting anybody but me. Wrong. It's hurting others around you that desires to eat off your tree. Amen. What a blessing it is for somebody to get up and testify in the Spirit of God. And buddy, I've seen it just be the key to the service, and people being lifted up and people being encouraged. Amen. But just simply obeying God and being in the will of God. And I thought about this. I've heard people say, "Well, preacher, I've heard people say I've got a song," and they get up and sing it, buddy. And it might not be, they might not be the most eloquent singer. Or they might not hit ever tune just right, but God be all over it. Amen. And people being lifted up and encouraged in the Lord, and God being lifted up. I've also heard people sing ever note just right, and it be dry and smoke, and it didn't help nothing. Amen. So it doesn't matter how perfect everything is. I believe a lot of times we're focused on the wrong things. We're focused on everything's got to be just right. Every note's got to be just right. Everything's got to be just right. And friend, we're more focused upon perfection than the Spirit of God sanctioning it. Amen? I'd rather God be on it, and no matter what it sounds like and what it looks like, than anything. We just let God be God. But there's a lot of things in our life we don't need, just like pruning that old tree. Purging it. Purging also means cleanse. In John 15, purging, he purges it, prune. That's what another word of purging there. But another word of purging is to cleanse as well, purge. And there's limbs that you don't take out, but there's limbs you trim. There's limbs there that I kept because they were good, strong limbs. But there was portions of that limb that it was shooting over on another limb that was important. So you take that limb out. And there's things in our life, and you don't have to ask me. You don't have to ask somebody else. You know what's hindering your growth. Clutter. Let me say this about clutter. Clutter can be time. It's hindering your growth with the Lord. You're spending time with everything else. You're making time. We can say, I don't have time. I don't have time for this. Or I don't have time for that. We make time to do what we want to do. We do. We make time. I don't care how many hours you work or how many days you work. You're going to make time to do what you want to do and what your heart desire is. And let me say, time spent with the Lord is time well spent. Very. Amen. And I think about this. I don't believe there'd be a one in here that could raise their hand and say that I want to hurt somebody or I want to hurt the church. Nobody wants to hurt the church. Nobody does. But when we neglect to spend time with God, we neglect to have prayer with God and produce good spiritual fruit in the Lord, we are hurting our church. That's a mouthful, ain't it? But we're hurting our church by not being led by the Spirit of God, not bearing good fruit. We are hurting those around us. We're hurting our young people when they're not seeing the good role models that we should be in the Lord. They're not seeing the good patterns. I mean, I think about Elijah, but Elijah had prayer with God and Elisha desired it. Not only did he want it, he wanted a double portion of what Elijah had. Amen. Thank God for people, amen, that lives the godly life that others would desire to have it. Amen. And it's not that you're seeing, that people seeing you. It's people needs to see Jesus in you. Elijah said, I'm going away. What? Anything I can do for you before I leave? And he said, I want a double portion of thy spirit. Amen. He said, well, you, in other words, you've asked a hard thing. But he said, but if you see me go away, it'll be given to you. He told him to tarry there for different places. And he said, where you go, I go. Where thou goest, I'll go. He was determined. It takes determination. And these people come by and said, do you know that Elijah's going to be taken away from you today? And he said, I know it. In other words, hold thy peace. Now the old devil wants to come by when you've got good intentions. You're really pumped up. You're really eager to grow in the Lord. You want to bear good fruit. And I pray God's challenged us all just like he's challenged me. We've all got room to grow in the Lord. We've all got dead limbs. Amen. And I've got enough work to do on my own life than to look over to somebody else's life or tree and say, oh, you've missed one. Huh? Because I've got a whole lot of limbs I need to take care of my life. Amen? But listen, when we focus on the Lord, and buddy, and God begins to bless, and we begin to bear fruit, amen. Now I think about when we start bearing good fruit in the Lord, these young people, they see the godly lives, and they'll want to desire what we've got. Amen. I've got nothing to offer this world but what's in my heart, and that's Jesus. I remember growing up and I could see people shout and see the excitement on people's faces and I didn't understand it. But when I began to grow spiritually in the Lord, I understood I want what they've got. And I understood I can have what they got. And I can have what, but it takes discipline. It takes discipline. It takes swallowing your pride and allowing God to prune you. There's things in our life. It might It might be pleasing to the flesh, but it's hurting the spirit. Jesus told the disciples there that as they were in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, "Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. For the spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak." Never trust the flesh. Sammy Allen, great man of God. He died with COVID just a few months ago. But he said, he told there how old he was and how long he'd been saved. And he said, "I still don't trust myself. Still don't trust this old flesh." A lot of times we get within ourselves and we get prideful and think, "Look how far we've come in the Lord. Look how much power I've got with God. Look how many times I've read God's word and how much knowledge." And we kind of get boastful and we get prideful. The Bible says, "Beware, take heed. When a man thinketh he standeth, take heed lest he fall." Pride has caused a lot of good people to fall flat of their faces. Good Christian people. Good godly people. Pride has caused a many, not just lay people, laymen, but also preachers. There's been a lot of preachers fall flat of their face when they've let pride get in the way. Pride has caused their fruit to rot. There's a lot of apples on the ground yesterday. That's because the fruit wasn't to its potential. It wasn't worth saving. It wasn't worth harvesting. So it's just laying on the ground, rotting. But next year is going to be different because that tree has been pruned. Every day don't have to be the same. Every week don't have to be the same. Every year don't have to be the same. Let me say this, in our Christian life does not have to be a life of chastisement. You ever feel that way? That your Christian life has been more chastisements, going through chastisements of competitive and repetitive sins than really spiritual growth? You ever felt that way? Well, it don't have to be that way when you get rid of the limb. You get rid of the clutter. You get rid of the hindrance. Get rid of it, and it won't be a problem anymore. Let me say this, and this is a mouthful. There's relationships that's harmful to your Christian life. There is friendships that can be harmful. Not just to young people. You see it a lot in young people, but not only young people, but adults as well. They might be acquaintances that's harmful to your Christian life. And you may feel, "Well, it doesn't affect me." Have you ever noticed this? Maybe, you know, a dog that's got fleas, another dog goes around it, it'll have fleas too. Have you ever noticed this? You pet a dog that's got fleas and you'll have fleas on you. A lot of times we're entertaining things that's affecting our life. People. You say, "Well, I'm stronger than that." No, you're not. You're no match for the devil. You're not that strong. We're weak, but God is strong. And we need to realize how weak we are. Because you get around people that cusses, and it almost seems like it's okay. It's the thing to do. You hang around that crowd long enough, then you'll be doing it. Hang around people that drinks, it's okay to them. It seems like it's okay. It's cool. Like cussing, I believe people think that it's cool. It makes you look big. But in reality, it makes you look small. Let me say this. It might not be the big things of drinking and cussing and doing all these bad things, but God's people can get caught up in spiritual sins and spiritual things that's detrimental. we can let our tongue rattle way too long. Talking about people, being busybodies. Amen? Talking about things we have no business talking about. Talking about people we have no business talking about. That can hurt your fruit. Instead of talking about them, we need to pray for them. Amen? I believe we talk too much. Hurts our fruit. Your tongue can hurt your fruit. It's full of deadly poison. How great a matter a little fire kindleth, the Bible says. Let's read about that real quick. I'm not done yet. You might want me to be done, but I'm not done yet. All right, James chapter number 4. Let's read that real quick. And by the help of the Lord, I might be done. Excuse me. James 3. James 3, it talks about, he said, behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us. Verse 3, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. A little fire. Now, I don't know, don't tell nobody, but I heard so-and-so done this. Now, I don't know that to be true, but so-and-so told me. Well, maybe you said not to tell it, but they did anyway. And they tagged your name on to it. So-and-so told me that this happened. Now let me say, that's hurt a lot of churches. That's hurt a lot of people's witnesses. A lot of people's reputation just because somebody was talking. Big fire started by just somebody's tongue, somebody talking. And the truth of it is, we've all done it. There ain't a one of us in here tonight that hadn't talked too much. Amen? But it's hurt our fruit and it's hurt our witness. When you see somebody talking about everybody, you better watch them. Because when you leave them, they're going to talk about you too. That's a fact. Don't be that person. Don't be that person. Because it hurts your witness with God. I don't trust people like that. Somebody wanting to talk about everybody. I don't trust people like that. Because you can't trust them because they'll stab you right in the back as well. Amen? But be the people that God wants you to be. Be the fruitful spiritual that people that can come to you and confide in you and know that you'll not go around talking about it, but you'll go to the Heavenly Father and tell Him about it. That's the people that we need to be, that people can trust. Not tell you something and then go back out and basically put it in the newspaper about it. But somebody can trust in you, confide in you, and you take it to the throne of heaven for them. That's the message tonight. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, that you know all about us and you know our tree. Help us to focus on our tree, not somebody else's. And think, well, if they'd have been here, boy, they could have been trimmed up tonight. But Lord, we're going to give account for our own tree. We're going to give account for our own life. And help us focus on our life. We thank you tonight. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Jane, come to the piano.